morning. Thanks for being here. We're going to take a dive down intellectually from that past speaking. I hate to say that. It's a hard show to follow. Thank you very much. I'm here today to talk about that practical application. This is a study that we just started in Minneapolis. We're in our first year. We just got the last trees in done in end of May. So we don't have results yet, but we want to talk about the study and how we're putting these applications out in the field. I must say that the reason we picked this particular topic, our unit just got switched from what's called regulatory services to the health department back in January. In order to get this approved here to come here, I have to make sure there's a public health angle. So thank you very much, Gretchen, for letting me come. But we're going to talk about what we're trying to focus on. We're on the verge of non-attainment for ozone in the city of Minneapolis. The urban canopy is a huge impact on what's called the heat island effect in the city. And as you know, ozone is very temperature dependent. And so that's really one of the big drivers for us in trying to do this, is to replace that urban canopy faster and reduce that heat island effect. Okay, the partners that we have in this particular project, this is something that we've put together fairly short order since the first time I met Nancy and such out in Kurt out in Massachusetts. It's been since that time that we put all this together, so in the last 9 months. So this has been quite an effort, but it's a coalition between the Minneapolis Health Department, the Shakopee Mdewakanton Sioux Community, the Minneapolis Parks and Rec Board, and the University of Minnesota. And the main reason I have that up there is I have the abbreviation so you can get used to that, because it's hard to keep sounding out Shakopee Mdewakanton Sioux Community. Okay, we're getting hit by the emerald ash borer. Many of us are familiar with it. It's come through the Chicago, Illinois area. Started up in Michigan, Ohio, working its way around. It just hit our area. As you can see, the beetle up in the upper left-hand corner. That's a pretty beetle, but the real thing is the larva down below. It gets under the bark, circles the bark. When it completely girdles the tree dies. It's pretty basic. Okay, non-native invasive species. It targets ash trees. Why is that important? Minnesota has the largest concentration of ash trees anywhere in the country. That's actually 998 million. We're just short of a billion ash trees. That's almost as many people as we have in Minnesota. That's a joke. I have to explain that. Within 6 years of detection in a tree stand, you see 100% mortality. And you'll see why this is very important to us. In 2010, emerald ash borer is first detected in Minneapolis. We have 40,000 public ash trees, but we also have 200,000 private ash trees. Ash trees compose about 21% of the Minneapolis urban canopy. Some counties or some cities are deciding to treat emerald ash borer. We don't recommend it. It's an inevitability. The trees are going to die. Why fight it? We're going to take care of it. One of the big reasons why we're not treating emerald ash borer is its possible effects on pollinators. And you see there is a bunch of dead bees. I can tell you, I just worked with my bees yesterday with the Star and Tribune. They were doing a big article on us. I keep bees on City Hall next Tuesday. Read the paper, Kurt. And as you can see by my oven mitt hands, they got through the gloves. In Minneapolis proper, what are we doing here? We have an 8-year emerald ash borer plan. What we're doing is removing 5,000 ash trees a year, and we've got a plan to only remove 20% on any particular block at any given moment. We're trying to diversify the replacements, and we're ramping up. Originally, the park board was replacing 2,000 trees a year, and that was hardly enough to keep up with normal wear and tear on public trees. And now we're going to have to ramp up to 10,000 trees. We have a huge problem with mortality. And how do we get these trees to stay healthy? And here's what it does. Why are we here today? As you can see, up in 2006, there's a nice tree-lined park in Ohio. 3 years later, they're all dead. That's what I just want to say here. Trees have an important effect on the air quality in the urban environment. They reduce temperature, that heat island effect, and ozone is very temperature dependent. So that's one of the main reasons there we're on the verge of non-attainment, and how do we help remove that threat. They remove air pollutants, both in through surface deposition of particulate matter and absorption of chemicals through the stoma. You do have emissions of VOCs from trees and emissions associated with maintenance of the trees. In our study, we concentrate on planting low-emission trees. We only have one low VOC emission trees. We only have one species that's rated as high. The other thing is net effect on energy on buildings. If you plant a tree, studies have shown in Minnesota and Hutchinson that up to 1,500 feet away from a building, it can still influence the effect on temperature in a building. And so that's the number one greenhouse gas emitter is actually public, or is the heating of buildings. So that's a way we're trying to affect climate change. What we had seen, why we're talking about public health, from 2002, 2007, Donovan did a study in EAB-infested counties, mainly in Michigan and Ohio. What the study found is that you see an increase in respiratory mortality, but really a big jump in cardiovascular mortality. And there's several reasons why. You got that heat island effect we talked about. Ozone increases. You have an increase in fine particulate at the neighborhood level, which is the big, bad, ugly thing for air pollution, as well as the stress from not having the green effect walking around. So we've seen an increase. We've seen an increase in mortality. For a Minneapolis has about 400,000 people, so we'd be looking, and this is per year, so about 24 additional deaths per year times four, about 100 additional deaths per year. So that's one of the reasons they justify me working on this project. Again, after the technical terms, I don't know if you can follow this, but little trees don't do as much as big trees. So it's a technical thing. Stay with me. The boulevard is a harsh environment. If you go down the salt, the roadways, you get snow piled up. They got the sidewalks, low, narrow boulevards, crummy soils. Urban soils are horrible. We have a loss of runoff. And the pollution reduction we talked about on the last slide, the loss of energy, savings, coolings, and the aesthetics. And all these are valued back in 2006 at $126 per tree per year. And now we're losing over 200,000 trees. Our problem statement is, how do we get little trees to successfully become big trees, and how do we replace those ecological services that we have now lost through the urban canopy? And this comes in our little project. And a lot of the folks here have been able to see this since its infancy, so watching a baby come around. What we have between the city of Minneapolis and the Shakopee Mdewakanton Sioux is an agreement. We have a memorandum of understanding. It's actually going to be signed by the mayor and the tribal chairman next month. It's in effect now. But it's a fairly large agreement, or good big agreement, between the tribe and the city. The tribe, what they have is an organics recycling facility down in Shakopee, just south of the cities. It's a very large facility, commercial composting facility, very professionally run. And what we're providing, the city is providing, is a truckload of biochar. And we're working together on an agreement to work within the city on primarily on agricultural sites, urban agriculture, and do demonstrations at the urban level to restore soils and promote food justice issues within the city. However, I put in a little clause into that other projects as suggested, which kind of allowed me to slide it up past city council that I'm doing this study. Don't tell them. But here's the results of what we've seen so far at the Meshkiki Gitagon, which is the medicine garden located in the Phillips neighborhood, which is an extremely poor neighborhood in South Minneapolis. And this is land that's donated by the Indian Health Board, and you'll see some shots way at the end of this project. But this is a corn spiral that we're looking at, and we have compost and biochar, and you can see the difference in the corn spiral between the two. And actually what turned out really well was their slash and burn. They actually burned corn stalks, had really good results. That partnership between the city and the tribe turned into another partnership with the Minneapolis Parks and Rec Board. We went and met with the Sustainability Forestry Director and brought up this idea about possibly using biochar to try to restore the urban forest. We have a large-scale tree replacement going on. We have a huge tree mortality program, and a lot of the little sticks weren't getting a chance to be big sticks. So we're trying to find a cost-effective means that works to restore the urban canopy and restore those services we talked about. We met with the University of Minnesota. They have the Park Board has a contract with the U of M, the Forest Resources Unit at the University of Minnesota. Gary Johnson is the chief investigator, and the person I'm working with is a research fellow by the name of Chad Giblin. And Chad and I, and then Mike Witt at the tribe, and Phil Podianki at the Park Board got together and developed up this study. for what we wanted to do and do a comparison to see if we can find a cost-effective soil amendment that will improve the survival rate and the growth rate performance of the trees. So how did we design this? First of all, what's our stock? We said the city is coming on up and providing the char. And as our keynote speaker mentioned, every char is not created equal. However, one of the practical applications I run into, I don't have an unlimited source of material. I can't get this, that, the other thing. I have to get what's out on the market. So I put out a query across the nation. As it turns out, Phil, who's located in the back here, won the competition. And we bought the material from a truckload of material last January from him, or last December. And imagine getting through finance saying, well, I want to buy a load of charcoal and dump it on the ground. Okay, Jim. It worked out really well. But the feedstock is an oak slab left over from mills. Here is an independent analysis of the material that we got. And again, it's from Energy America Solution, LLC. And if you have any questions on the material, Phil will be available in the back to answer any questions you have, plus hand out sales brochures. So here's the nutrient levels. And we talked about the tribe providing the manure, the compost. They have a lot of different sources that work with them. And you said that this really goes in the line of their seven generations sustainability. They really care about the earth, and so they really jumped on board with this project. They donated a lot of composted manure for me to work with it and did the mixing down at the facility and transported it wherever I wanted it to go. So I got it started. I provided a truckload of charcoal, but the tribe's been doing a hell lot of heavy lifting on this project. The study itself is a totally randomized study. We had a statistician independent at the University of Minnesota come on up and design the locations. And what we're looking at is 440 boulevard trees. I know it said 600. Originally, that's what they had told me. Then I did the math and had to downgrade. It turns out that my non-PhD math was better than their PhD math. But we have 11 different species in the study. Talk about the diversity. We have 10 cultivars and one seedling, so it takes out the genetic variability. The oak that we have in here is the only one. It doesn't adapt to grafting, so we had to use the seedling. It's all bare root. If you're familiar with tree plantings, in most part what we're looking at in urban forestry is ball and burlap, bare root, or containerized. And the containerized is fairly expensive. The industry is getting away from ball and burlap, B&B. This year we did 6,100 trees. Only 25% were ball and burlap. The rest were bare root. Makes a lot more economical and faster to plant the trees. So this, what we're trying to see is how this amendment works with bare root trees. And all the trees here, 1.75 inch diameter, so they aren't little sticks that are going on the ground. They're actually fairly medium-sized sticks. And here are all the species that we look at. You can see a good diversity. The one thing you notice, I know this is a bad slide, I mainly put it on in here so you can link later on if you're interested. But in the replacement here, we see a number of elms. And these are all species of elms that developed through the University of Minnesota that are resistant to the Dutch elm disease. And the elms provide a very strong degree of environmental protection. They take a while to get there, but the number one as far as environmental protection, followed by ash trees, followed by maple. And you'll also notice that there are no maples in this mix. And the reason is that we've already got more than enough maples in our diversity. If we add any more to the mix, we're going to start skewing it and setting ourselves up for the next disaster, which is, I believe, the Chinese longhorn beetle, which is making its way from Chicago. Thank you. The material that we actually used in this case was a 5-to-1 compost biochar mix. We have 8 replicates per treatment. The statistician told us that 5 or 6 treatments or replicates would be adequate for the study. We want to make sure we had a little buffer in here for it in case we had loss. And sure enough, we lost some apple trees because somebody jumped the gun on getting the trees into the ground. But the treatment rates that you see here, we have 5 treatment rates. And this is all very scientific, based on buckets. So there's our bucket that's 22 quarts, and we put it in a plastic. I'll show you. We got put it on a plastic bags that are color coded. So one bucket, one bag, and if it's blue, it's biochar. If it's red, it's compost. And then we just give instructions to the tree crew. This location gets 2 blue bags. This location gets 1 red bag. go to town. We had our own dedicated tree crew to do the study. We also had controls. The information that we collected, and we're just, the reason I showed that map before with all the little dots, it's totally randomized across the city. Black dots meant the data had been collected. The open dots would mean it hadn't. We have undergrad students running around right now collecting that data. We expect to have the data completed before the start of the actual school year at the end of this month. All those will be here. This is the information we're collecting originally. And you notice very important stem caliper at 15 and 30 centimeters. In order to have repeatability, we had to take a magic marker and mark the stem where they're taking that location rather than measuring it, because believe it or not, in some of these studies, trees actually shrink. I see Kurt and a couple other people nodding. And then follow up. This is a 5-year study. We were going to do soil compaction during the first year. We ran out of resources, and so we'd be doing it during the third year. But these are the information we're getting here. We're hoping by the end of July next year we'll have an indication of the results. At that point, we're looking at ramping this. If it looks like it's successful, trying to ramp it up to cover more of the trees that are being done and expand the study. And the university is looking at trying to do it in different cities. The main thing here is that we're going to be collecting data every 5 years thereafter until the end of the last tree dies. One of the things here is during the first 5 years are really critical for trees to grow. So that's where and get them to survive. So that's what we're really concentrating on, is that first 5 years. And then just to see it in action, this is the mixing. That's Chad in the lower left hand. He's the researcher, so he gets to shovel the manure. The grad student's left holding the bag of manure. I don't know, there's a metaphor in there somewhere. And then on the other side, down on the lower, they're doing the compost manure in the lower right. That is the compost only crew. And a bunch of grad students coming on out and shoveling the stuff for us. And then preparation. We hand dug a hole. Originally was talking about we were looking to auger holes. The equipment's very limited, and it was hard to put it onto this study. So we had a couple guys with shovels, and within a couple of minutes, they have a hole dug that's 30 inches around and 8 to 10 inches deep. There's Chad up there applying the material. Looks like one bag of biochar that would be going into the hole and mixed with the backfill. In lower right, you'll see the bare root tree that's going into the hole, and the other ones are shown in planting. The guys backfill it, come on in, they treat each one the same. A little rim around there for water, and the final result is the new stick in the boulevard. What the outcomes are, the product that we're going to be having on this is at the end of the first year, we'll actually have a report, or we'll have an indication, preliminary data on the effect of it. What we know so far is that all our trees are alive. We haven't killed them yet, so that's good. Then at the end of 3 years, and 1 and 3, we'll have preliminary reporting and a full report that we intend to publish in a journal at the end of 5 years. Some of the issues we're looking at now, if at the end of first year we're looking at good results, taking the preliminary data, how do we scale that study up going from a pilot to a full-blown study? And working that in, it isn't as easy. This one, we could boutique it, have our own crew, and do this. But how do we integrate this into the tree operations of the park board? Because we're dealing with folks that in a month are ramping up, they're doubling or tripling their production. How do we do this and not slow down the production or the planting of the trees? And so we want to work this into their operation. It's not as easy as it is, and we've been having a lot of discussions. We hope that it'll be going quite a good, and hope I get more work out of our public work so I can move material around. We're looking at expanding the study out to three different communities to try to get a geographic dispersion across the state, as well as take a look at different soil conditions. The last thing is Clean Air Minnesota, which is a coalition between major state agencies, private businesses, and a lot of nonprofits, such as the Pollution Control Agency, Lung People, XL Energy, etc. We're a member of that, and I'm on the Committee for Urban Forestry, and we're looking at this as a possible solution for the heat island, and how do we expand this, and it's actually being reported up to the EPA as part of our effort under our SIP plan, the state implementation plan, to avoid non-attainment as one of our methods, how we're avoiding PM2.5 and ozone. So, that said, just an aerial view of the Meshkiki Gitagon And on the left-hand side, you can see the biochar and the growth of the project as it goes along. So September 2nd, that's where we're having the signing ceremony. If you're in Minneapolis, feel free to stop on by. September 2nd, right after Labor Day.